trick. Hello? Who's there? Oh, is this one of your cheap tricks? Guess not. No tricks for Annie tonight.
I enjoy scaring people a lot. I enjoy suspense and action and thrills. And I enjoy comedy. I guess mainly the genres of films. I'm big on form and structure. And within a certain context, doing certain things. The film I'm making now, Halloween, hopefully will be is a horror film, loaded with scares, suspense scares, hopefully not grisly or gory, but suspenseful, making people on the edge of their seats. I enjoy doing that.
John Carpenter is a young Hollywood director who seems to be quite successful at keeping people on the edge of their seats. We talked to him last summer in Pasadena on the location of his new thriller, Halloween, which has just opened in London. The interesting thing about him was, and is, that he hustled his way into the film business pretty young. He's only 31 now, with two features that cost nothing to make, weren't thought much of by the studios, but caught on in a remarkable way internationally to become something of a cult. His first, Dark Star, started life as a 45-minute sci-fi spoof that he and a pal made at film school for $6,000. A distributor saw it, pumped another $50,000 in, and turned it into a feature that looked as though it cost 10 times as much. They made the spacesuits out of old second-hand firemen's asbestos suits with vacuum cleaner hoses, biscuit tins, and styrofoam packing from a typewriter case. The crew have been in space for 20 Earth years, zipping about aimlessly, zapping stray, unstable planets. They're all unhinged with boredom. The skipper's dead, packed in the freezer, but still mysteriously conscious. They're troubled with a talking bomb that insists on exploding under them, since, it reasons, it cannot ignore a haywire computer's signal. They're also harassed by a ship's mascot, an alien blob, which someone said looks like a beach ball with claws and a nasty sense of humor, as we'll see in a moment. This curious success was followed by a vicious, single-minded siege story, Assault on Precinct 13, a grim tale of mindless urban guerrillas who attack a police station. It deliberately had no so-called redeeming social message, and the same could be said for the new film, Halloween, which sets out simply to scare the pants off you. A criminally insane youth has broken out of his institution on All Hallows' Eve and returned to the scene of his crime where, as you might expect, he sets about reducing the population. Donald Pleasance as his despairing doctor and a local sheriff gingerly inspect the deserted mansion.
There's no one here. He could have seen them through this window. Standing on the front lawn, he could have seen inside.
Pat, very good.
We preferred to talk to Carpenter outside rather than inside the house, and we returned first to the subject of Dark Star and how his original short version got off the ground.
The 45-minute version had a plot, a very tight-plotted story, and what I did was fleshed it out, made it much longer. That, I think, is the weakness of Dark Star, is that, in essence, at first it wasn't a feature idea, but was made into a feature idea. Therefore, some places are very slow and episodic, which is not my kind of filmmaking.
Your kind of filmmaking. My kind of filmmaking by John Carpenter.
Yes. My kind of filmmaking is a very plotted, structured film from beginning to end. I don't like episodic movies. I like a lot of form and structure.
But you've already said that actually in Dark Star and in Assault, there are episodes deliberately built into it.
Within the context of a plot that continues right from the first frame. And in Dark Star, it meandered. It meandered quite a bit.
One thing about Dark Star that you didn't intend was that it should be funny, first of all.
No, I did intend that, right from the start. It was to be funny all the way. It was to be an absurdist comedy rather than a slapstick comedy or a farce. And we, you know, started out to make a funny science fiction movie.
I read that you... I mean, do you think science fiction is funny, or do you just think that the movies have made them funny?
Neither. I just don't think one had ever been made, and I wanted to make one. closest film to it was, I guess, Dr. Strangelove, which Kubrick said it, he started making the film, and the more he worked on it and the more serious it was, the funnier it got. And the same thing happened with Dark Star. We had these guys out in space for 20 years, and there were no women, and they were bombing planets, and it was a pretty meaningless existence. And so I figured, well, that's ridiculous. It's so grim, it began to get really funny.
The ship's mascot, the alien blob, gets playful and bounces into a lift shaft from which he has to be retrieved by one of the crew. The mixture of thrill and joke is typical of Carpenter. Dark Star was meant as a rebuff to the solemnity of films like Kubrick's 2001.
Attention, attention. Elevator descending. Please clear the shaft.
There are two kinds of science fiction film. One is Lobster Men from Mars, and one is socio-religious films or books and novels. I prefer the first, Lobster Men from Mars. Just my personal preference. I don't like... What I hate worse than anything else is pretension in any form. Somebody who's pretentious and is delivering a message. Because I don't think film, motion pictures, is at all intellectual. I think it's all feelings. People laughing, crying, screaming, etc. Getting excited, getting upset, whatever. And when there's a message to it, it's not my kind of movie.
Would you not say there's some kind of a message going on in Dark Star or in Assault Precinct?
Perhaps it's not my intention, though. The intention is to entertain. And I think anything good has a substance or a theme to it. A thematic material is different than a message. People who deliver a message is like a public service broadcast or commercial. This is what I believe, and you must believe this too. I think any great work has a theme, though. And the theme can be discerned from a message in that it's not hitting you over the head or stating something, but is a little more subtle.
In other words, you're saying that you actually do quite like ideas, but you don't want them to be paramount.
Well, I don't think they can be, because first and foremost, I think, in my opinion, that films are to entertain, to be entertained and to feel. And it's through the feelings that you get from watching a film that you're going to derive the theme and the importance of the movie.
Dr. Chapman, could an airplane melt that much ice?
One of our own jets generates enough heat to warm a 50-story office building.
Here's one of the old movies that Carpenter reveres. Howard Hawks is a Thing from Another World. Starts with an alien spaceship crashing into a frozen lake, and from it, the Thing will emerge.
Part of an airfoil, probably a stabilizer of some sort.
It's an airplane, all right.
Flores, can you tell what metal that is?
I'll need some tools.
Barnes, bring some tools.
Hey, it's down pretty deep over here. I can't see anything but
in a dark mass.
It's deeper over here.
Captain, may I suggest that we spread out and try to determine the size and shape?
Right. Spread out, everybody. We're going to try to figure out the shape of this thing.
Carpenter loves the thing so much he has everybody watching it on TV in Halloween as a presage of disaster.
What movies do you go to for choice, for entertainment yourself?
A lot of old films, older films by Hitchcock, Hawks, Ford. I like Polanski. I like action films. I go to see most movies just to see if I can learn something.
What about your contemporaries, Lucas, Spielberg, De Palma?
I don't care for them.
Any of them?
I think George Lucas made a good film, American Graffiti. Very good. I think Steven Spielberg, Jaws was good. They made a lot of money.
That's not quite the same as being good. You liked Jaws, but you didn't really like Close Encounters, no? Why?
No, I didn't. I didn't care for it. And just, again, it was pretentious, and I think it got out of control, and I think he lost control of it. And there were parts of it that were not well done. I just didn't care for it as much. Didn't have a single purpose in it. It went off in several directions. One of the things I admire about a great work is that even if it's flawed, that the director is completely in control of it. And it is he directs the film or tells the story with a great deal of authority. And I felt that that wasn't there in Close Encounters.
Can't you envisage sometimes movies being directed by people who are on the edge of experimentation with a form or with a subject and who are investigating them? I'm thinking of people like Altman in Nashville, for example, where you feel that he's stretching the boundaries of narrative and...
That's one way to look at it. Another way is he's flogging around in the swamps. I don't care for Altman's work at all. I think he's not a good filmmaker.
Not a good filmmaker?
Not a good filmmaker. I'm in the minority. I know a lot of people respect him and like his films. I don't care for him. I think they're slightly masturbatory.
I think you would like the clock to have stopped at about 1948, wouldn't you?
That would be fun. That was when I was born, but I like old-fashioned movies.
Red River or something.
Yeah. Red River would be fine. You could go up into the 60s.
You go as far as Rio Bravo, perhaps.
You can go up to El Dorado and maybe stop there.
not Lobo.
Oh, yeah.
Hard man, that Carpenter. He knows what he likes anyway, and what he really likes is goodies and baddies, and no fancy pants shilly-shallying around in between. The goodies are right and must live, the baddies are wrong and must die. The goodies have their reasons, the baddies don't. Not only that, they have no character and no identity. So, on the one hand, you have nice teenage girls and boys. On the other, you have the faceless monster in the Halloween mask. Or if you like, on the one hand, you have Walter Brennan and John Duke Wayne. And on the other, the Indians.
Tom, we could have been wrong about that smoke. Oh, she might have got away.
Here they are.
I hope they ain't too many of them.
Talking of John Wayne, you may remember that he plays Sheriff John T. Chance in Hawks's Western Rear Bravo, classic tale of a besieged jailhouse. Now, the film editor on Assault on Precinct 13 appears to be someone called John T. Chance, Carpenter himself, of course, I suppose, and as well as echoing the siege plot of Rio Bravo, Assault is full of references to it. As in Red River, the enemy are just nameless, mindless menaces, somewhere out there in the bushes.
They're in those trees over there.
Why would anybody shoot at a police station?
Stalker! Lock the doors! Stay down away from the windows!
Phone breaks down, the lights go off, with the highway patrol running the place, it's amateur night in Dixie. Oh. Ah!
You're not gonna let us sit in here. At least take these cuffs off. Hey! Hey!
Back on the Halloween location, I had a word with Donald Pleasance, who plays the killer's frightened psychiatrist, to see what he thought about Carpenter when he accepted the part.
I think he's good, as far as I can see. I saw his... I've only seen one of his films. I saw Assault on Precinct 13. And I admired it a lot. There were things about it which I didn't understand, but my teenage children explained it to me when I came back.
What things?
Well, I didn't quite understand to what extent the film was intended to be tongue-in-cheek. There were parts of it which I couldn't actually accept. As there are parts of the script which I'm now doing for John, which I can't accept. But I have to bring myself round to seeing it in his way, because it's his film, and then I can accept them.
Can you be specific about that without being rude?
I believe people are behaving in a way in which they couldn't possibly in real life behave. And that's always difficult, because if you're one of the people, then you're the one who's going to look like an idiot. If the director doesn't have some very good reason for people saying lines which people don't really say. It's, in other words, I think the script is a bit overwritten. That's, I don't know, it's difficult to find an expression other than that, overwritten. I never quite know what it means. But I think it's a little melodramatic, and certainly in my role. But of course, it's not intended to be real in that awful word, realistic sense.
Is there anything in the scene that we're now going to see, which is the... You're going over the house, aren't you?
What scene are you going to see? Because we're just shooting it, and when you get this program out...
No, the we're
actually going to see this shot.
To film this rehearsal. Of this shot, which is you and someone else going over the house.
Yes, the local sheriff.
It sounds as if they're getting the Alsatians out after us.
Yeah, I think it's the Brits around. They're coming after you. Us.
Pleasance, veteran as he is of spine chillers, was nevertheless taken aback by Carpenter's relentless pursuit of the cliché. The old dark house, the bumps in the night, the daft lines that seem to turn all the characters into zombies. Carpenter treads scrupulously in the footsteps of the formula.
It happened here.
There's no one here. Two sitting. could have seen this with this window. Standing on the front lawn, he could have seen the sign.
All right, not bad. Not too bad.
Not too bad, yeah.
Not too bad. Right? Should... feel better to have it happen in here and then you leave?
Well, I think she was sitting right here.
I do say
it's good to line to get him because that gives him his thoughts for rumination.
Exactly.
Doc Pleasance and the sheriff know that the first dreadful deed was done here, in this room, when the monster was a little boy of 6. Now he's a maniac killer of 20 and on the loose. He's bound to come back. He may even be here now.
Yeah. But when they were doing the deed, the sexual deed...
Oh, my God.
Yes. He could have seen them.
Oh.
Time off.
She was sitting right here.
When he killed
her? Yes, right.
Yeah.
He could have seen them.
Yes.
Yes, of course.
And then you want me to come in after that, John?
I think he gives you... She was sitting right here. Off you go. Let Donald hang in there a second. Come back. There's no one here. Then we cross to the window.
He could have seen them through the window. Standing on the front lawn, he could have seen inside.
Smash-o. Crash-o. All right. Feel all right?
Yeah.
What exactly happens? We put in a piece of fake glass, and a rain gutter will come in and break it and scare you. You'll pull out.
How do you see that happen from outside?
We will see it happen from about right here.
So you both pull our guns out now?
No.
I think let him pull his gun out.
It's the first time I see his gun.
Yes.
I mean, this I don't want to get the idea
this about. It's a big moment. I'm going to show you my
See, if you both pulled your guns, it might be like a draw or something.
Burn,
both start shooting each other.
Boomer. I mean, if that happened, it'd just scare the shit out of you right off.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dean, are we ready to shoot one?
What is that?
It's a dog.
It's still warm.
He got hungry.
Could have been a skunk.
Could have.
Man wouldn't do that.
This isn't a man.
Could have seen inside. You must think me a very sinister doctor. I do have a permit.
Seems to me you're just plain scared.
Yes. Yeah, I am. I met him 15 years ago. I was told there was nothing left. No reason, no conscience, no understanding, and even the most rudimentary sense of life or death, of good or evil, right or wrong. I met this 6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face and the blackest eyes, the devil's eyes. I spent 8 years trying to reach him, and then another 7 trying to keep him locked up because I realized that what was living behind that boy's eyes was purely and simply evil.
What do we do?
He's been here once tonight. I think he'll come back. I'm going to wait for him.
You also said once that you'd like the clock to stop and you to go back to the 40s.
I would love to be a director during the 40s in a studio situation. I would have loved it, working on sound stages. Having that kind of control, that kind of style.
But yet a lot of the directors from those days testify to the fact that they didn't have control.
maybe it's the fantasy that I'm responding to and the way the films looked and the way they came off more than the reality. I think it depends on the director. I've heard stories to the contrary that people have having complete control, and I've heard stories where it was a factory. I think you're going to get that all the time anyway, in any situation.
What, do you mean that people would be confused?
They're both. There are both. There are directors who do have control, and there are situations where you don't.
But I could imagine a director from the 40s looking forward to the 70s and thinking, my God, if only I had the freedom that John Carpenter has to write, direct, produce, edit, write his own music.
Ah, I see. Now, perhaps so. Perhaps so. I hadn't thought of it that way. I, on the other hand, well, I would still like to have those freedoms, but the styles, I guess I'm talking about, of the 40s, the types of movies they made and the types of situations. It seems to me that films have been kind of ruined by television and by commercials especially. In the 60s, people just went crazy and forgot about form, said to hell with it. You know, we don't need a lot of structure here. And it's gotten so to the point now that when you devise a film that in style is a bit old-fashioned and has a lot of dolly shots and the lighting is molded and is three-dimensional, and people say, well, it's phony. I don't think so. I think it's just a different style, and I'm sorry to see that style go, as it was rich with a lot of textures. And I think that's probably what I'm responding to when I say I'd like the clock to stop.
I can't say I altogether agree with him that nowadays we've lost the richness and texture of style just because we've lost the simplicity of some of the old genre. You might cite as an example another new American film from a contemporary of Carpenter's, Paul Schrader, which just opened in London. It's called Blue Collar, and it's a violent, foul-mouthed story about car workers in Detroit. Schrader's previously written rather than directed. He wrote Obsession for Brian De Palma and Taxi Driver for Scorsese. The main difference between him and Carpenter is that he had very little film culture at all, or sense of tradition. His father, a strict Calvinist, didn't let him go to the movies till he was 18. But no one could accuse Taxi Driver of not being rich in texture, or Blue Collar, for that matter, for not telling a dramatic story. Here's a scene where a corrupt union boss buys off a worker who's blackmailing him by offering him a union job. Powerful, oblique storytelling, socially accurate, a script so ultra-realistic that we can't screen most of it because of the language, Blue Collar is, you might think, the very opposite of Halloween. We should be glad there's room for them both. And that's all tonight. We'll be back in 2 weeks' time with something completely different. Join us a fortnight tonight. Good night.